Are you ready for your encouragement? You don't sound convincing. Are you ready for your encouragement?
Yes!
He's ready for the encouragement too. Friends, Temple of Light family, it is my absolute pleasure to invite our pastor, Reverend John, to bring this morning's encouragement, as he calls it. I'm sure it's going to be quite inspirational, as it always is, and give us food for thought and some homework. All right, please welcome Reverend John Scott.
Good morning, family. Every encouragement is really for the person giving the encouragement. You know that. It's out of our own consciousness, yes? So welcome. And welcome to those who join us on the World Wide Web. I was putting up my Christmas tree yesterday. Putting up a Christmas tree is really a very sweet, sad ritual for me. And as I was putting it up, I knew that Faye Kessler and Tina, and I understand Sean was helping them, must have been performing the same labor of love here at the temple. It's thank you, Tina and Faye and Sean. It is beautiful. Let's give them another round of applause. I found some interesting lore regarding the origins of the Christmas tree, and I wanted to share a little bit with you. Evidently, the Christmas tree tradition has ancient origins, dating all the way back to ancient Egypt. The Egyptians were part of a long line of cultures that treasured and worshipped evergreens. When the winter solstice arrived, they brought green date palm leaves into their homes to symbolize life's triumph over death. The Romans celebrated the winter solstice with a feast called Saturnalia in honor of Saturnus, the god of agriculture. They decorated their houses with greens and lights and exchanged gifts, giving coins for prosperity, pastries for happiness, thank you, Liz, looking forward to yours, and lamps to light one's journey through life. According to the lore I Googled, late in the Middle Ages, Germans and Scandinavians placed evergreen trees inside their homes or just outside their doors to show their hope in the forthcoming spring. So our modern Christmas tree evolved from these early traditions. Until about 1700, the use of Christmas trees appears to have been confined to the Rhine River district. But from 1700s on, when lights were accepted as part of the decorations, the Christmas tree was well on its way to becoming a tradition in Germany. So it was from Germany that many of our Christmas customs, songs, you know, oh Tannenbaum, wie grün sind deine Blätter. So it's the songs and the music and the tradition of putting hand-blown glass ornaments on evergreen trees, that whole tradition really was coming out of Germany. So how did that tradition travel across the many miles and end up here in beautiful Jamaica? According to the tradition, Queen Victoria often visited relatives in Germany in the town of Coburg. And while there one year, she fell in love with a young Prince Albert. After they got married, they returned to England to raise their family. The tree that Prince Albert provided his family their first Christmas together was admired by all in England. And this tree was decorated in the finest of hand-blown glass ornaments. Since everyone liked the Queen, they copied her Christmas customs, including the Christmas tree and ornaments. Interesting, eh? So I expected hop the pond now from Britain with the colonial occupiers to Jamaica. I remember the years when Douglas firs, anybody here remember when we imported Douglas firs from Canada? They were very, very expensive. And I'm so glad that we're growing our own now. And I love the scent of our Jamaican pines. So the imported firs were just out of the reach of so many people. And my tradition of decorating a Christmas tree every year actually is born of my own dad's inability to afford one Christmas. So this has led me to put up a Christmas tree every year as a tribute to his love. And I'll tell you the story. It was Christmas Eve, 1947. As the story goes, my dad had provided all the essentials for his family. There was food for Christmas and drink. Presents had been bought for Mommy, Dennis, my brother, and me, but there was no money to buy a Christmas tree. And the last thing little Johnny said as Daddy went through the door was, "Don't forget to bring home a Christmas tree or Santa won't have anything to put the presents under." And so as my dad, after work on Christmas Eve, made his way along King Street in Kingston, he saw an approaching tram and thought for a moment, just for a fleeting moment, "You know, if I just throw myself across the tracks, Johnny and Dennis and Dotty," was what my mother was called, "would never have another problem because he had taken out a large insurance policy, you know, £500 or something in those days. They would never again want for a Christmas tree at Christmas." It was just a fleeting thought, and following it very, very rapidly, evidently, was the idea, you need to pray. You're crazy if you think you could abandon your family. And so he went to the bottom of King Street and sat on the, there was a pier down there, and he sat there looking across the harbor at the horizon. And out of that, gazing towards the horizon on a Christmas Eve, a solution dawned in his mind, and he made his way home to his family. On Christmas morning, my friends, when we awakened, there was a little Christmas tree about 2'6", if my memory serves me right, in the living room. Daddy had sat up all night making holes in a broomstick with an awl, you know, one of those little things, by hand, every which way across the broomstick, and then using clothes hangers unwrapped and wrapped in green crepe paper, had fashioned an exquisite, perfectly proportioned tree, complete with a string of pepper lights and topped by a star made of cardboard and covered with the silver paper from his packet of cigarettes. I just thought it was the most beautiful tree I'd ever seen. There were just four ornaments. He said, one for Mommy, one for Dennis, one for me, and one for the Spirit of God that gave him the idea. It wasn't one for him. And I thought, well, the star is for you. You are a star. You know, friends, to commemorate that demonstration of love, as simple as it may seem, every year I put up a tree in my father's memory, and I say a prayer for every ornament I hang on the tree. Tom Riley, an expert in value-added selling, tells a story titled "The Master Eagle's Lesson" that reminds me of my own dad sitting on the pier looking across Kingston Harbor and thinking, what if? What if I threw myself on the tram tracks? What if my family didn't have a caregiver? So I'd like to tell you that story about the Master Eagle. Would you like to hear it?
Yes.
The nest of young eagles hung on every word as the Master Eagle described his exploits in the great skies beyond their nest. This was an important day for the eaglets. They were preparing for their first solar flight from the nest, and it was the confidence builder many of them needed to fulfill their own destiny. "How far can I travel?" asked one of the eaglets. "How far can you see?" responded the Master Eagle. "Well, how high can I fly?" quizzed the young eaglet. "How far can you stretch your wings?" asked the old eagle. "How long will I fly?" the eaglet persisted. "How far is the horizon?" the mentor rebounded. "Okay, how much can I dream? How much should I dream?" asked the eaglet. "Well, how much can you dream?" smiled the older, wiser eagle. "Okay, one last question. How much can I achieve?" the young eagle continued. "How much can you believe?" the old eagle asked. Frustrated by the banter, the young eagle demanded, "Why don't you answer my questions?" I did. "Yes, but you answered them with other questions." I answered them the best I could. "But you're the master eagle. You're supposed to know everything. If you can't answer these questions, who can?" "You," the old eagle said. "You can." "Me? How?" The young eagle was confused. "No one can tell you how high to fly or how much to dream. No one can tell you how high to fly or how much you can dream. It's different for each eagle. Only God and you know how far you'll go. No one on this earth knows your potential or what's in your heart. You alone will answer that. The only thing that limits you is the edge of your imagination." The young eagle was puzzled by this and asked, "Well then, sir, what should I do?" And the old eagle said, "Look to the horizon, spread your wings, and fly. Look to the horizon, spread your wings, and fly." And that is the title of my encouragement this morning. For friends, it takes faith, it really takes faith, to let go of the old familiar ways of doing and being, and to trust the infinite intelligence within us to enlighten and to lighten us, so that we can rise up out of the ruts into which we may have stumbled, or out of the nest, which though familiar, no longer serves us, or which we have outgrown. Often it calls for a leap of faith into the unknown. We could say then that faith is the flowing attitude that takes us from where we are to where we want to go, the wings, if you will, that help us to fly to our greatest potential. And sometimes we have to take that first step without even knowing where the completed journey will take us, yes? To just say, "I have the faith to take that first step." So follow the advice of the Master Eagle and look to the horizon this Christmas. Spread your wings and fly. And you might say, "I want to, Reverend John. I like the young eaglet, I want to. But how can I be certain that I will make it? What if?" You see that what if business there? That what if, you know, is a dangerous, dangerous what ifness. You ever wanted to do something and one little mind is like a little chatterbox on your shoulder saying, "What if? What if it don't work? What if the people at work don't like it? What if the boy, mother, and father don't like me? What if I fail?" And for some people, it's even a stronger what if. What if I succeed? What am I going to do with this? What if? What ifs can paralyze you and may immobilize you and keep you in the rut. They can keep you from making a decision. They can fill you with dread and throw cold water on your dreams. But I want you to know this morning, as we prepare to celebrate the coming of something so glorious in our lives, the idea that we are divine, the idea that beautiful story about a little baby born in a manger is not just an ancient piece of lore, it is our own story of our own potential, of our own divinity, and of the fact that we come with the tools to do away with the what ifs, to look to the horizon, to spread our wings, and my friends, to soar to our divine potential. And the way you silence it, or the way I silence it when I hear the what ifs come into my mind, is I can because I am. Can we say that together? I can because I am. You see, this little powerful affirmation. Don't misunderstand or put down the power of affirmative thoughts, because it's what you can use to just wipe out that little chatterbox voice in your that's on your left shoulder or your right shoulder. You know, for some people, it actually has the voice of somebody they know. Mine was my grandmother, who always said, "Give me that, you're too clumsy, let me do it." And so whenever I'm trying to do anything that requires grace, I can actually hear that little voice saying, "Give me that, give me, let me thread that needle, you're too clumsy, it's going to take you all day to find the needle eye." So I grew up with a concept that I was clumsy. That's how, you know, and so I'd be waiting in the wings to go on stage as a dancer, and the little what if would say, "What if the first your tail and you're instead of the center of the stage in the orchestra pit? And you're broke here, ask me no question. What if? But thank God for this teaching I've learned. You can say to that what if voice, "Thank you for sharing, but I can handle it. I can because I am." Let me hear you say that. I can because I am. So this brings me to your assignment. I know we have the pleasure this morning in the audience of having the International CEO of the Year. She wasn't here last week when we were beginning her up. Where is she? The only woman from a whole sea of mere men who were put up for the award. And you know, I just think it's so wonderful, because when you have that kind of mission, the what-ifs can really sit on your shoulder and the chatterbox. You need to say, "I can because I am. I've come fully equipped." So well done, Kelly. Just wonderful, wonderful. So your assignment today is to make a list of 3 what-ifs that habitually take away your peace of mind. And beside each one, write in big, bold letters what? "I can because I am." Really get a feeling of the power of these 5 little words. Because friends, whether you believe it or not, you really can handle whatever comes up in your life in the most creative and fulfilling ways. Bless you. You can handle it because you come fully equipped with all the talents, abilities, and intelligence to make life. You can be assured, to borrow a term from motor car salespeople, that you come fully loaded. I said it to a lady, I think she took it the wrong way. But you are fully loaded because the Creator made you in his image and, well, she was amply endowed. The Creator made you in the image and likeness of its perfection. And that's no Victoria's Secret. All you have to do is to get the hang of listening to the still small voice within you rather than the chatterbox voice of your little self. My grandmother used to say too to me, "Your mouth go and get you in trouble." You just have to love me as I am, warts and all. But how do you know if it's the still small voice of your little doubtings or your little doubting self? And I'm going to tell you how you know. The voice of God always whispers life-affirming, uplifting, noble ideas that benefit everyone. The voice of God always gives you something that benefits all of life. So if you find any sense of negativity creeping in, that's not the still small voice, that's your ego self. And you know, I belong to several WhatsApp groups. One is a WhatsApp group of our practitioners, but there are many. There's one that our own practitioner, Stevie Golding, started called The Posse. I want to suggest to all of you who are on WhatsApp groups that you look at what you pass on that group. Ask yourself the question, which I learned from our founding minister, Dr. Elmer Lumsden, years ago, before you post anything, is it necessary? Is it true? And is it kind? And if it doesn't pass through those three golden gates, it's not the voice of God. And you may want to consider not passing that on. No matter how useful you may think it is to warn people that, you know, people are following people home at night. You know. Nobody's following me home, I regret to say. So, you see, so you don't want to spoil the fun for people like me. I can't say anymore. It's so hard to be a minister. Let us affirm together, through the power of God within me, I can handle what happens in my life in a loving and powerful way. Let me say it together. Say it for you. Through the power of God within me, I can handle all that happens in my life. That through the power of God within me, I can handle all that happens in my life.
Through the power of God within me, I can handle all that happens in my life.
In a loving and powerful way. With God, I can soar to undreamed heights of excellence. With God, I can soar to undreamed heights of excellence. I love this one. This is just, I want the ladies to say this first. We'll all say it after. It's the ladies alone. I come fully loaded.
I come fully loaded.
Yes, let's all say it with them. I come fully loaded. Friends, we're all going through an eternal process of self-discovery. Each of us is creating our own destiny moment by moment by our habitual thoughts and deeply held beliefs. When we accept that whatever happens is neither good nor bad, but is an opportunity to discover the power of God's presence in our life, then we can begin to fly rather than crawl through life. We can look to the horizon, spread our wings, and take off, knowing that there is a place of security to which we can always return. And that place of security is the kingdom of God, which Jesus said is within us all. The kingdom of God, which I like to call the kingdom of God, is our true home. One of the great New Thought writers, Eric Butterworth, tells the joke of the caterpillar which looked up and saw a colorful butterfly flitting overhead. He shook his head ruefully and said, "They'll never get me up in one of those contraptions." And you know what, friends? They never will. A caterpillar simply cannot fly. But the creature will change its embodiment. And as it does, it becomes something entirely different. As if by a miracle, suddenly there's a whole new set of principles at work, and the creature soars to a whole new potentiality. The beautiful Jesus, recognizing this divine potential that is within us all, knew that we were not born to crawl but to soar, and soar we must because it is our divine destiny. The caterpillar has no choice but to become something exquisite and beautiful and light as air. The goal then is sure to be attained by all, regardless of what evaluation we make of our lives from the human standpoint, because there is that within us that transcends the human. As Butterworth puts it in that quote, "You can't make a butterfly out of a caterpillar, and you can't make an egg spread its wings and float over a canyon. More than this, you can't make a good man out of a bad man." This is logical on the human level of evaluation. But in a way beyond knowing, the caterpillar becomes a cocoon and then breaks loose into a winged creature of the air. And the eggshell breaks and the bird steps forth. And listen to this, because I tell myself this every Tuesday afternoon when I enter that prison down on King Street, on the bottom of Tower Street. Butterworth says, "The so-called evil man suddenly sees a new potential in himself and begins to act upon that potential." Because, friends, that potential is within every single person. There is a hunger and a thirst after righteousness that is inborn in all humanity. And in fact, I believe it is born in all life kind. All of life seeks to have a closer relationship with the source of its beingness. So when we know the truth of this great spiritual potential within us that Jesus called the kingdom of God within, we are free to become our unlimited self, free to do unlimited things. We see things in a different light. We react to a different set of principles. We draw upon a higher potential, a potential that has always been within us and which has always really been the truth about us. Henry David Thoreau, the American essayist, philosopher, and abolitionist, writing in Walden, explains it like this, and I quote, "If one advances confidently in the direction of his dreams and endeavors to live the life which he has imagined, he will meet with a success unexpected in common hours. He will put something behind, will pass an invisible boundary. New universal and more liberal laws will begin to establish themselves around and within him. Or the old laws will be expanded and interpreted in his favor in a more liberal sense. And he will live with the license of a higher order of beings." Unquote. Imagine what it would be if we all lived with the license of a higher order of beings. That we would see everything from the standpoint of its purity, its beauty, its wholeness, and its holiness. And then it wouldn't matter what another person is wearing or doing. You would see them as God sees all of creation and calls it good and very good. My friend Tony Henry is laughing because my car had a flat tire on the way to work, on the way to church this morning. And I parked it off on the road by Jamaica House and called him, and he came to rescue me. So he's in church in shorts and barefooted. I love it. Thank you, my friend. This is what I call living with the license of a higher order of beings. I wasn't going to say anything, and I was going to wait until many people say, "Oh, no, see Tony Henry, you know, he was in church barefoot. You know, him and the pastor share a house, and what's that going to reflect on the ministry?" You know, live from a higher order of beingness. It's God. It's God. Let us just say, it's God. It's God. It's God alone, my friends. It doesn't matter what we're wearing or what we're doing, or sometime when my head take me and my mouth say anything we feel for say. Just know it is God, and it is coming from a place of pure love. I know some people walk away from the church because them can't take Reverend John or what he might have to say. I love you. Trust me. One of my favorite meditations in the Science of Mind textbook is titled, "I Am Complete in Thee." It is found on page 549. And in it, Ernest Holmes, the founder of this great teaching known as the Science of Mind, addressing the infinite presence within, affirms this. Maybe you want to just gently close your eyes and drink this in. "I am renewed and refreshed. My whole being responds to thy love, and I am complete in thee. All my ways are guarded and guided, and I shall live with thee eternally. O lover of my soul and keeper of my spirit, none can separate us, for we are one. O lover of my soul and keeper of my spirit, none can separate us. For this Christmas you are born in the stable of my life, in the manger of my heart, amid the hubbub and the clamor and the chaos of the outer world. There is peace in my soul." And as Steve Golding wrote in this piece, "I am whole. It is God here in me. This is my reality. For gentleness is not weak. It allows the still, small voice
to speak. And so this is how we approach this Christmas, in the knowledge that within us is all the power and all the beauty. O lover of my soul and keeper of my spirit, none can separate us, for we are one. Can we say that together? O lover of my soul and keeper of my spirit, none can separate us, for we are one. O lover of my soul and keeper of my spirit, none can separate us, for we are one. Today I look to the horizon of my divine potential. Together, today I look to the horizon of my divine potential. I spread my spiritual wings and soar to the highest heights of attainment. I spread my spiritual wings and soar to the highest heights of attainment. Thank you, God.
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 And so it is. Namaste.